Poor Eunice. After much thought and consideration, Eunice decides to visit a cousin of hers and explain her challenges to him. Her cousin saw the moment as a great opportunity and immediately transferred the money to her. She was surprised and happy and thanked him, but she had no idea what her cousin had in mind. He dragged her back and forced himself on her, taking advantage of her innocence and desperation. She struggled with him, but her strength failed her. Eunice is crying, as she never imagined this could happen to her. She couldn't believe what was happening. After much thought, Eunice decides to tell an aunt of hers about what had happened and her wanting to take the case to court to get justice. Her aunt refused and discouraged her because of the stigma that could follow from friends, families, religious institutions, and all around.
No, we're reporting.
Eunice is no longer herself as the news had spread, and she's finding it hard to recover from the experience. She takes the case to social media and starts asking questions out of frustration. She discovers she was pregnant and eventually killed herself because she couldn't deal with the stigma. End sexual abuse.
Research has it that the rate of sexual assault and abuse keeps increasing every day, hence the need for awareness as reason. Of course, this is Yagi on your favorite station, and today we're going to be discussing about sexual assault, its vices and prevention measures. And we have a very wonderful woman in the studio today. She's an author, an activist. She has survived this thing, or this, I'll refer to it as stigma, called sexual assault. And she has traveled far and wide, and she's quite experienced in this field. Her name is Mrs. Fatima Ishiaku. You're welcome to the studio, Ma.
Thank you for having me.
it's such a pleasure to have you today on the show.
Thank you.
I've read your profile. I know about you. And I can imagine the kind of things you've gone through from your childhood to this very present age, but still you're glowing and then...
I just have to. It wasn't like this, you know. Looking at my pictures and thinking of when I tried to commit suicide and the love I get from people, sometimes I wish I had that love when I tried to commit suicide. But I think I'm happy because I'm using my story to help victims.
Wow.
Like me, we don't have to hide our face anymore.
True.
We just have to
come out and speak out.
Don't hide behind the curtain to tell your story.
Wow. I'm just so excited to even learn from you. All right, today we're going to be seeing something very special. This is here. I call him that. This is a very resourceful one for every single person, for both male and female. Yeah. For those that is
young and old.
True. Ma, I'd like to even know a Bagam story. Can you tell us something about you?
Okay, first, for the viewer, let me introduce myself.
Okay.
My name is Fatima Ada Ishiaku. I'm the author of the book I Call Him Dad. Then I'm the current ambassador to Say No to Rape campaign under His Imperial Majesty the Oni of Ife, through Princess Ronke Ademuli, the founder of African Fashion Week London and Nigeria.
Wow. How was growing up like for you, Ma? Thinking of the fact that you wrote a book on rape and survival measures.
Growing up for me was not fun, was not interesting. It was all about pain, trying to commit suicide, and my stepfather trying to remind me of how ugly.
Wow, your stepfather.
Yes. So I grew up thinking he was my biological dad. So not knowing that he was my stepfather. So it wasn't an easy thing for me. My childhood, I don't like talking about it, but I have to.
True.
Because I have to tell my childhood story for people to understand what I went through in life. So, but it's not an interesting childhood story.
I can imagine.
Even as an adult, the stigma, it's still there, even to today. I still get a lot of stigma.
Up till now?
Yes. But the best part is I learned to draw strength from stigma. So I learned to look at those that stigmatize me now. I learned to look at them in the face and I just said, at least I have a story.
That's true, man.
So I don't let it get to me anymore. But I'm trying to heal because a lot of damage was done to me. So, don't make me emotional now.
I won't, I promise.
Don't make me emotional, please.
Moving on to the topic for today, sexual assault. In your own definition, what would you say sexual assault is?
To me, forcefully taking the dignity of an innocent male child and female child. Because people talk about rape, you think it's only the girl child that is being raped.
True.
We don't know that a boy child is also sodomized every day in our society. So if you're thinking you're going to that, okay, she's a girl, because she's indecently dressed, that is why she's being raped. No.
True.
Because a lot of boy child is being sodomized, but even when they grow up, they don't speak out.
Wow. Now, thinking of the fact that guys get exposed to such acts, like, what would you say to such, do I call a victim now? What would you say to such a victim that's gone through sexual assault?
Speak out.
Speak out.
I'm the thinking first of... stage for healing. If you want to heal,
okay,
it's not forget people coming to tell you that counseling, you wore the shoe. You know the pain you went through. So I don't believe in counselors. I only went to counseling to see a psychologist because I'm destroying my own self with my own hand. That's the reason why. Because nobody can tell me to how to heal. Don't give me pill to heal. If crying, if speaking out, crying, telling someone my story would make me heal. I should. I will. So speaking out is the first stage of healing.
Okay.
The second stage of healing, where a lot of people don't want to do, is forgiveness.
Forgiveness. About speaking out, thinking about society in Nigeria, it could be very funny. A guy coming out to say, I was raped. People will laugh. No one would even believe, even if it's 18.
I have a lot of, I have like 2-3 friend guys that were raped, that were sodomized, you know. But so most of the time, when they just tell me, I was okay, speak out.
Speak
that
out.
Way you're helping someone. How did you overcome? How did you heal? You know, I say, hey, you want me to tell the world that that's why raped. I'm not man enough. You know, they don't want to speak out. They just say, how did you do it? The same way a female child come out to speak out, that is the same way you should. So it doesn't matter if you don't want the world to know that as a man they raped you. How will you heal? Some men are not healed to date. They're not. Wow. So why are you holding? But I'm telling you, speaking out is one of the greatest. No matter the psychologist or the therapist you see, if you don't speak out, tell your story, you will never get healed. Don't let people stop you when you're crying. You want to cry? Cry. That is a relief when you cry. So people don't understand. People just think, I want to come out and come and tell a victim, oh, forget it, Fatima, it's a past story. Wear the shoe. When it hurts you, you will understand. So if you're a victim, you need to come out, tell your story. If you want to cry, cry. You need to heal from the pain, the thing that's hurting you, before you deal with the stigma.
So does crying really help?
Yes, crying really help. Because just speak, cry. But don't cry on the wrong shoulder.
Do not cry on the wrong shoulder. Wow.
Because the bully will hurt you more than the rape. I've been there, so I've experienced it.
So that means when you cry to the wrong shoulder, you might end up falling into a wrong trap. To a trap, rather.
Yeah. Because a lot of victims, mostly the girl child that is being raped, they never experience love, and they fall into the wrong hand. They want to hear something that they've never heard before. I love you, I'll care for you. But then, oh, cry, you start passing you. Oh, this person love me. They will rape you all over again. They'll take advantage of you. And the next day you call them, they'll say, oh, please, I've been there.
Wow.
So I rather speak out when I'm doing speaking engagement or television or friends that I really trust that have been there for me from day one. I rather cry and once I'm getting my healing than me going to a wrong person because I haven't taken advantage of because I'm vulnerable.
Wow.
So that happened to a lot of victims also.
There's still so much to talk about, but now we need to go on a quick break. Stick around. This is Yagi.
Thank you.
Welcome back. If you're just joining us, this is Yagi on your favorite station. Now, we have a very special guest with us today, Mrs. Fatima Ishiaku, and we're discussing about sexual assault.
Welcome back.
Welcome back, ma. I'm sure we're able to ease off the all.
Yes.
Before the break.
Yes, I was happy. It's a happy calm down.
Calm down. Yes. All right, we're still discussing about sexual assault, but now we're diving into the prevention measures for sexual assault. What would you recommend as the prevention measures for sexual assault?
Prevention
measures.
I mean, you know, when people ask me this, I just take our time to answer because I don't want to say things that will offend a lot of people, a lot of parents. If you talk about prevention, we have a long way to go.
Okay.
Mothers, who are you getting married to? Because a lot of children have been raped by their fathers. Who is your partner? Landlord. Who is the tenant you put in your house where you have a girl child?
Okay.
A lot of young children are being raped by their neighbors. Teachers. Who are you employing in school? Who are you employing to be a teacher? Because a lot of children are raped, both boys and girls, by their teacher.
Teachers.
Who are the family member you trust? Who are the pastors you trust? You leave your children for deliverance, they rape your children.
True. Awesome.
So if we start going, these are the things you need to look at. Because a lot of people think they know about rape. You've never been raped before, you just read it in the book and you come, and because mostly rape in Nigeria is a business now.
That's
true. A lot of NGOs.
That's true.
Okay, bring her, we heal, they drop. What happened to the girl? How will she get here? What are you teaching parents? How are you teaching parents to protect their children? Are you teaching parents to speak out? People think dressing is the reason for rape.
Exactly. I was gonna go to the dressing part.
It's not dressing.
At times people believe when you come out and then you're dressed in a very provocative way, or there's a part of your body being exposed and then you get raped. People say, why did you go out like that? People tend to blame ladies most times for the way they dress.
What if the baby that wear that pass that is being raped? Look, people that rape innocent people, both young boy and young girl, are mentally deranged. They have a psychological problem. It's a psychological problem. I know a lot of girls that dress half naked. They've never been raped. Recently, a young girl, she's 7 years old, her grandmother, because I have an NGO that I run, so I have all these cases every day. A young girl, she's 7, her mother is in Lagos, she handed it over to her grandmother. Our grandmother was using this 7-year-old girl for a sex slave. Men came to have sex with this girl, pay 500 naira, 1000 naira, 1500 naira, something like 7 men sleep with her a day
with a child.
You telling me that woman have not done that to her daughter? If she can do that to her granddaughter? It is not dressing. It is the greed of people, greed of some mothers, psychological problem of some sick father. It has nothing to do with rape. A lot of young boys have phone, they go to the internet, they watch
pornography.
I can't hear myself. They watch a lot of pornography, and once they watch a lot of that pornography, what happened?
The kids tend to want to practice what they've seen.
Now, a lot of young boys and girls are into drugs.
Young girls, you date anyhow man, you don't even know, initiate you into drugs, and you want that drugs, you don't have it. You have to give your body.
What do you?
For someone to have sex with you. For you just to have that drugs.
So that means the place of education even comes in. Like talking.
Who is educating the children? You want, you, if I go to you, if I have a daughter and you want to teach her sex education, you call a man to teach her. I said, I will sue that school. Because how are you educating a girl on sex education? Are you going to say, where's your body part?
So a woman breast? Should do the duty of educating a girl child.
Even as a woman, do not use any child body as an example. You don't have that right to touch any child body part. You do not have that right. So it goes a long way, because we live in a society where everybody feel they know about rape.
That's true. Even in the news, someone just come out
and go and carry one paper and read and just, so I'm talking about rape. What do you know about rape? How can you educate them? It's deeper than what we think. Mothers, you know, some guys are just so sick when they see a young girl private part. A mother will go to a restaurant, undress her child, change the diaper. That child, that man is turned on. And start looking for somebody else to defy. You can't find that person. You go home and see your sister or you see your neighbor, you defy. It is not like that when you dress in, then we used to dress in front of our younger brothers. But now you can't, because some of them are into drugs. You can't anymore.
So now it's very dicey to trust people.
It's, of course,
very dicey.
You know, during the pandemic, do you know how many fathers were caught raping their children?
Wow.
A child always wants to give you a sign that something is going on. But some mother just get to neglect, just like, you know.
That means
yes.
Parents need to look out for signs.
There's always a sign.
There's always a sign.
But their marriage means a lot to them, or the name of the family means a lot to them.
So they don't want to drag the dignity of the family in the mud. But the advice to always look for a sign. Look out for a sign.
There's always a sign.
Wow. All right, guys, you can put a call through if you'd like to join the conversation. This is Yagi. Thank you.
So a lot, you know, so if we start talking about rape prevention, we're going to take like 2 months. We'll not say it, but you need to understand it. A lot of people that feel they know about rape, they come and say, okay.
Hello. Yeah, good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Welcome to the show.
Yeah, Olasu calling by name.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm watching your program. I love it.
Thank
and
you.
And kudos to you, Ms. Fatima Ishiaku.
Thank you.
Well done, ma.
Thank you very much.
Well, my question is that, watching the program, you're talking about, like, the victim should speak out. How can a victim speak out without an evidence?
How can a victim speak out without an evidence?
It doesn't matter. Look, that's because,
okay, because I've seen some situation like when a victim speak out, or EHP took herself to the police station, they were like, oh yeah, where is the evidence? Where is the video clip and all? So how can a victim speak out without an evidence?
This is one of the things that have destroyed our society. This is one of the things. First, let me say, when you have a relationship with a man, he's your boyfriend, and the relationship end. You've been dating for long and relationship end. Please don't go and say the guy raped you. That is not rape. You had a relationship. It ended. But when you forcefully take advantage of an innocent child, that is rape. Now, because we live in a society whereby we don't have the equipment to prove that this guy raped.
That's true.
But the truth is of the matter is, when you go to report a case, you should know when a girl or a boy is telling you that he or she was raped. But we live in a society whereby bribe has covered the eyes of our so-called security operative, whereby when a child go and say they've been raped, you say you want an evidence. Sometimes publish is what, and a lot of people don't speak out because when you tell, I will kill you.
That's true.
That is what my stepfather told me. I never said it to my mother. See, when my mother wanted to know if I was still a virgin, she found out I wasn't a virgin. That was when she almost wanted to beat me again. That was when I opened my mouth and I told her the truth. But my stepfather never denied it. He said it was the devil's work. Same thing, a lot of children have been threatened to maintain their silence. Don't speak out. If you speak, I'll kill you. Probably they are tired. If you have the necessary equipment to test, you know that, or something that can, what's that word again? The one they put for someone to say the truth.
Lie detector.
Yes. If you use that and there's some equipment, you find it sweat, or you definitely know that this guy defied that girl. You know when someone is telling you the truth. Do you know people, how can I come out and say that my stepfather is late, that my stepfather, when I have siblings, when I have family, do you know people see I kiss me, that I'm lying, that I'm looking for fame? I never published this book in Nigeria. I could have been in the America and start making my life. But I had to come back to Nigeria because it's getting worse in Nigeria. So when somebody come and say that she's raped, the best thing for them to do is to do a proper investigation.
Investigation. Okay.
No young child will come and tell you that she's raped, she's not raped.
Okay.
So our system is corrupt. Whereby we see a lot of young girls that is being raped, they arrest the man. After a few days, the man have money, they release him. If a pastor yep a girl, his member, support him. Call the girl all sort of name.
Okay, ma'am.
Society starts supporting victims and seeing the truth. Rape will reduce.
I pray our situation plays out on rape victims, because our society are not helping plays at all.
Society is doing more damage to the
victims. More damage, putting fear on victims. I pray they solve this out.
If they don't, see, rape in Nigeria, if they stop using it as a business, start speaking the truth. Our society starts, our leaders pass a law and do the right thing. Rape will reduce. If they
thank you, ma. Thank you, ma.
Thank you.
Thanks for calling.
So, if they don't do that, rape will continue. The rape will not stop.
So, the authorities need to play their own part.
Yes.
In curbing rape.
It's getting worse and worse and worse and worse every
day.
Every year of like 2 or 3 cases, father defiling their children, neighbor, teacher, pastor, is getting worse.
But speaking of rape, at times it sounds absurd when a woman, like a married woman, says, my husband raped me. Is it possible? Is it possible?
You're putting me on a dilemma here.
Is it possible?
Yes, it's possible. Because, okay, is this program for adult or young children?
For both.
For both. Okay. I'm being careful. Sex between couples is meant to be something that a couple should enjoy. You know, most time it's just like a man. When I have a friend who always said, oh, our husband, when she wants to have her husband, he reject her. That he's stressed, he's tired from war. She will not force him. Same thing. If a man wants his wife and the wife says, no, I'm tired, or she's going through pain, or maybe there's time for her menstruation and stuff like that.
But
but in our society, in our culture,
okay,
your husband cannot rape you.
I was about to say that in the normal culture, Nigerian setting.
No, in the Nigerian setting, your husband cannot
rape you. Cannot rape you.
That's your responsibility as a wife. And I think at the end of the day, you have a relationship between you and your husband that's supposed to be, an understanding. If my husband comes, okay, I want this.
Okay.
If my mood, the way I talk to him, the way I respond and tell him, I say, oh, probably this, I'm not in the mood, something is wrong with me. He will understand. But you can't have two masters in the same house. True. You cannot say them, no, I will not do it. This, that, or you did not give me money that I need more. You don't feed me. You don't take care of me.
Hmm.
You don't. You understand me? So.
That's true.
But in this part, I don't even like talking about it because
it's I'm sensitive. Not married,
so it's between. I don't like because I'm always careful when I say things that.
Has to do with marriage.
Yes, well, it has to do with marriage. You know?
All right, we're going to take a break now. Guys, stick around. Welcome back if you're just joining us. Before we went on the break, we were discussing about the disadvantaged devices and effects of sexual assaults on both the male and the female child. Moving on, we're going to be discussing about the disadvantages of not speaking out. What happens to you if you don't speak out?
I don't care if people say that when you don't speak out that you get hit. You won't get hit. Because there is that pain of being raped. But you can get healed when you have someone that came into your life. So that people come to your life to wipe away every pain.
Okay.
Pain. But if you are a virgin, that your virginity was taken. And you met this person that was nice, that's always that pain that why didn't I meet this person
before it happened to me?
Why did this person stole my innocence? One time you'd be sleeping, you just
go mad.
Just get mad and just, you know, or you just think about it. You start becoming so aggressive, you don't even want your partner to come close. Because sometimes most people that don't speak out hates men. They call all men all sort of name. That is one of the mistakes we make.
True.
We have so many. We have more good men in our society than the bad ones.
It's so hard to believe that we have more good men in our society.
Than the bad one. So you start seeing other men as evil. I don't want to get married. I don't want to come close to men. I don't like black people. You know, I see them as monsters, but later I get to realize that monster has to do with it. It doesn't matter your skin color.
It's from within.
Yes. So once you don't speak out, the pain, there's something you're holding on to. You're just like when you're married, but you're still in love with your ex. You cannot find, you won't find, you need to tell even your partner that, look, some secrets you shouldn't go with them to your grave. You need to speak out. You need to say, okay, look, because I'm telling you, you might meet that person
again,
and the shock and the fear, you don't even know when you open your mouth and say, that is the person that raped me.
So it comes out fresh again when you cite the person. Yes.
So why not just speak out? I'm telling you, healing is not just at once. It might take 10 years, it might take 2 years, it might take 1 year, it might take one day, it might just somebody just help you wipe away your pains.
Okay, so one of the remedies or the ways to overcome being sexually assaulted is speaking out.
You have to speak
out. You have to speak out.
Oprah did the same. Just me, I did the same.
True.
But the thing with our society that we support them.
But we don't support our own people.
We mock our own people that come out to speak out. We stigmatize them. People say, why not hide your face? I say, no, why should I hide my face? I have a unique story.
Very true.
So why am I going to hide myself with people that have story they cannot share to the world? They're dying inside. So me, I'm sharing my story. I'm trying to heal. And you're telling me not to hide. I'm not going to hide my face. It will come to a point where every victim, one victim are not scared to hide their face. I'm telling you, there's going to be a problem.
So one, speak out. Two, forgive yourself.
You have to forgive yourself. You have to forgive the person that did that to you.
It can be tough. You wanting to forgive someone who took...
Do you know I forgive my stepfather?
But it's hard for me to forgive my mother.
For not speaking out or helping out?
Because a lot of the physical... myself, I caused enmity between me and my mother.
Okay.
The story is in my book. And my mother hated me. She started maltreating me. All these scars was... One time my mother cut my hand with blade that I should bleed to death. So now it's not the what I went through for my hand. I see it as my destiny. I see that God allowed me to go through that pain for me to be able to use
it to help others.
Now, but when I look at the physical scar I have on my hand, on my head, that my mother break my head with the rod.
With the rod?
Yes. So it brings me back that sad,
sad memories.
And when I went, I blame her for putting me through this. Because she never told me it was not my father.
For years.
So I was 14. When she found out I was raped, I decided to find me from the age of 5. I was 14.
Wow, speaking of your book, I guess that must have been the inspiration behind writing this.
Yeah. Good afternoon. I'm to Fatima.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah. It's a wonderful program.
Thank you.
My name is Mr. Kundi. I'm calling from Lagos. My question is this. Issues, is it demonic influence that motivates the people to do such things? And two, me as a victim, what advice or a mindset can we pass across to victims to love good men in society again? It's wonderful. I don't understand all this.
Okay, sorry, sir. You have to ask me the second question again, but I didn't get that. Okay, let me answer the first part. Firstly,
thank you very much.
It's a psychological. I don't think scientifically they believe about demonic.
So demonic.
Let me use the word. It's a psychological problem.
Problem.
Yes. And secondly, is a peer group influence. Thirdly, the thing that people hear, a man will say when he have sexual intercourse with a young girl, make him look young.
That's so sad.
So it is a lot. You know, if I start breaking it now, I don't think we have a lot of time. So it's a psychological trauma, it's a psychological sickness, it's a mental disorder.
Second question. Hello?
Yeah, we're with you.
Yes, sir.
Okay. The second question is this. As a victim.
Yes.
Previously, I understand. Can one come out of expectation and loving good men in the society again?
You know, thank you for asking that question. Before I see all men, mostly black men, as monsters, I was going through the rape and stuff like that, then when I met my Soki, my first boyfriend that late, he changed my mind
about men.
About men. I saw men in different
light
and tide. And I met another white guy, made me see men in a different light. Yes, victim fall in love again when they meet the right person. But it take a long time. You have to be sure, because a lot of men that come to victim only want to come and take advantage of her all over again. That's happened to me.
Okay.
Yeah, so we are good men. Victim fall in love again.
Well, thank you very much. I put your name down, be praying for you.
That is very
God will heal you.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
All right.
Thank you so much for calling in. Speaking about what he spoke about, moving on, he said, can it be demonic?
What is demonic?
As Africans, we know there are things like that that exist.
Because when I see a lot of, when I get posts where people now say he's a demonic devil, man, I bind dire spirit, this person is mentally sick. Which demon went to enter into rape?
But at times they get to say, oh, I didn't mean to do it, the devil just pushed me to do it.
What devil pushed them to do it? They want to do it.
True.
Be careful what you watch. Be careful what you listen to. People like, oh, have you heard of a man that when he sleep with his daughter, his friends can't give him money to sleep his daughter's also?
Things are really happening.
That is what they do. The kind of friends they keep. The thing they hear, ah, what is in that girl that her father, if I sleep with daughter, maybe if I would do it. They take all drugs. You take drugs that your hair cannot carry. You take all kind of drinks. And now, you get turned on. When you see your daughter pass, you think she's one girl. You are
eyeing somebody else.
So why are you blaming?
So we can't put the blame on the devil.
Which devil?
So it starts with every single person. It starts with the man. It starts with you.
It starts with you. When you know you can't drink, your hair can't, why are you doing it? A lot of young boys and girls are into drugs.
True.
You take sex enhance. You take all these things that enhance your sex drive. When you start looking for a woman, you don't see your child is there. Who tell you to be taking things?
That means we need to control what we take here.
Yes. So you cannot control yourself. And a lot of mother. Listen, if you're a woman and a young child is staying with you, you're physically, mentally abusing that child, you're also a rapist. You're not different from a rapist. Because most of you women do more harm to innocent children than those that defy them. So a lot of women come out and say no to rape,
but then they cover up the stories in the houses.
They come out, their husband is defying their maid, their daughters. But their marriage means a lot. A lot of young boys, girls, see their body, hot water. True. I'm angry. You don't have any right to come out and say no to rape. What have you done to the body of that child? You don't feed that child. That child don't go to school. You are saying no to rape. A lot of women don't want harm to children. Okay. Abuse, assault, more than that. Don't women rape boys?
Yes.
So we should, it's not just men.
So it doesn't just have to do with the perpetrator. It has to do with people covering up also.
People covering up us also. Women rape children, use boys to satisfy their crazy sexual desires. So I don't say because you're a woman, I trust you, I'll let my boy try.
Stay with
when me. I know you're crazy, my boy will not go and stay in your house. I don't trust you. So we should also put in blame on only on men. That women in this society, they are defiling children also every day. They take all drink and they get turned on. They are looking for, they start bringing one boy and turn them. Mothers, you're giving your children phone. Your children go on site. Look at the phone of the little girls. They were stripping naked. Dancing is everywhere, viral. And people were sharing that video. Please stop sharing it.
Okay.
Because some sick people are watching it. Men, this small girl can do this.
So they can go behind their back and then find out what the person is.
Stop sharing it. They were naked, putting all kind of things on their private parts. These children are no more than 7 years. It's on site. Everywhere we're sharing it. So if you want to, I do rape prevention science to look at for and oppose. 2 life, 3 life, 5 life.
So people ignore until it happens to them or someone close to them.
When I go and post, when I dress and I post on social media,
they like pictures.
500, 700. Mm. When you put comedy, it's go viral. Mm. But what will save a girl child and a boy child? Mm. You will not do it.
So now the society needs to take this as a serious thing.
Yes.
A serious
Don't
issue.
Wait till it happens to your child. Mm. When you hear it, speak out. Talk. Mm. Stand for the truth. Mm.
So do not wait till it happens to your friend or your child or someone close to you. When you see or see signs, speak out.
Help that girl. Mm. A guy calling. Come and take sweets. You're there watching. Uncle, you buy her sweets. My own uncle. Mm. Why are you telling her to come to your room to come and take sweets? Mm. Why? You go and meet the mother and tell the mother that this guy is sending your child to come and take sweets. Mm. The mother needs to see that child to ask her question. So because it's not your child, you don't care. Mm. It's a lot.
A lot, much.
If we do this in the right way, rape will reduce.
Wow, so much insight. I'm sure you're enjoying the show as well as I am. I would like you to talk about your book. We'd like to know more about what you wrote in this book. Mm.
This girl, you're putting me a lot of stress. Okay. I don't mind me, I'm just joking.
Okay.
This is part of my healing process where I talk, I joke, I laugh, you know. It puts me in a good mood, not start thinking about it. So don't mind me. I never want to write this book.
So what inspired you to write? What triggered it?
So I went with my friend Doris Chinasa Ariole. She's a movie producer and a writer.
Okay.
So a movie was nominated in Orlando, America. So the benevolence, so I had to go for the premiere.
Okay.
And there was an actress, Doris Simon, that also came to talk about her own movie. Mm-hmm. But in that movie, it has to do with rape and malaria. I think it was sponsored by UNICEF.
Okay.
In that movie, her father raped her, she got pregnant, later a child died of malaria. So it was time for question and answer. And our parents in diaspora were shying away from rape.
Hmm.
We're only talking about malaria.
Hmm. So no one ever spoke about the rape aspect?
No.
Hmm.
And I was pale. I was bleeding. I was sad.
Hmm.
My heart was broken. So I raised my hand. Hmm. So the owner of the art gallery,
okay,
Uncle Tim told them to give me the mic, and I told them, I said, I'm surprised that our parents in diaspora are also shying away from the truth.
Hmm.
That this is not all about malaria, as the two elements, but one is strong, which is rape.
Okay,
I said, look at me, I'm a victim. Stigma, not speaking out, is what has kept me like this.
Hmm.
So I tried to commit suicide so many times. I became an alcoholic. I became a club girl.
Mm-hmm.
It's all in my book.
So those are the psychological effects of
sexual assault. Yes, in case somebody mm-hmm. come and say, ah, she used to go to cook club. I don't write that for my book. So everything about me is there. Mm-hmm. You don't have any. So everything in my life is there.
It's in the book.
Yes. So I was an American professor, an elderly man. So and I said, now, and I said, what are you celebrity doing about rape in Nigeria? It's getting worse.
Mm.
But people just keep quiet as nothing is happening.
Okay.
I said, now, people, I'm so surprised. Our friend, that's why I'm talking about malaria. I'm talking about it. Now, why was I? Mm. As an American, when I finished, I just saw that people were like,
I'm trying to calm you down.
Calm. I said, American professor, I said, you need to write a book. I said, me.
Mm.
Talking about my rape cost me to engage me, and I close that chapter. So I'm not getting married.
Okay.
When I now say, okay, this is the thing everybody know, my family. Why would I not tell my partner?
Okay.
And I told the two guys I was engaging. So the end.
They left.
Say they can't. Say they're an abomination. I'm a cursed child. I'm a taboo. This, that, that. And me said I just ex that.
Zero to men for now.
Yes. For now, I want to focus on what I'm doing. That was an American professor told me to write a book. I said, I'm not going to do it. So you have to do it.
Mm.
So it took me to the studio. It was a trauma. I thought I was just scattered. I don't want to do it anymore. Because it kept bringing us so many sad memories. So at the end of the day, we did it. 2016. Then the first writer, because I was recording,
okay.
The man died. So it wasn't an easy process. I had to, but before he had a cancer, he told me in case he didn't make it, I should promise him that I must
publish the book.
Yeah. So, and I was a flood, all everything in the house damaged. We didn't have my manuscript anymore. So I had to
start over again.
Wrote the book, republish it back in America. So it wasn't an easy process.
Okay. I'd like to ask you a question again. One more question. How long does it take to heal from rape? How long does it take? Does it take days, months, years?
I'm not healed. For like almost 40 years, I'm not healed. For me, so some that I fell in love, get healed. I'm tired of telling people that I'm healed.
So there's point.
80% healed.
There's no point lying to yourself if you've healed you. Yes, know.
Because you need to tell victim the truth. Don't tell them it's an easy process. It is not.
It's not an easy process.
Yes, you need to tell them the thing they will go through, the pain, more pain. Are you ready for it? So the more I speak out, the more victim come to me, the more I help victim, the more I get healed. So they draw strength from my strength. I draw strength from that healing. So I'm healing. So I don't know how long. Oprah still cry when she talk her story.
True.
Jasmine still cry when she talk of her story. So.
So healing takes time.
It takes time.
Wow! Thank you so much for joining us.
Just open your heart for healing.
All right, ma'am.
So you can get my book in my website, houseoffatima.org, Glandora Bookshop, Okwida Bookshop, Havila Bookshop, Robin Heights.
Okay. And you didn't talk about your foundation.
Yes. My foundation basically is to help the boy child and the girl child that is being raped.
Okay, so someone can just put a call through and call your hotline and talk to you.
House of Fatima for Abuse Girl Foundation. Our number is 080-571-20299 or 080-230-81407. You know, so or info@houseoffatima.org. Yes, I got
all
it.
All right, you can go online and check the House of Fatima. Just Google House of Fatima, you find more information.
Yes.
Thank you so much for joining us on the show. I hope this was insightful for you as well.
One more thing,
okay?
Please, if you are a victim, speak out.
Speak out.
And if you're a young man or old man out there, please don't rape anybody. You're going to destroy your future. So let's make our society free of rapists. Dressing is not the reason for rape, but dress responsibly.
Dress responsibly.
Yes.
So that means you need to watch how you step out as well, knowing that there could be wolves out there.
Yes. But it's not the reason, but dress responsibly.
Dress responsibly.
And say no to, say no to drugs.
Okay.
I see COVID. Wash your hand. Keep your social distances. And take your vaccine. It's safe.
Thank you so much, Ma. Thank you for the insights. Thank you for joining us on the show. I had much fun. And I'm sure everyone who joined us today must have enjoyed and learned one or two things. This is Yagi. My name is Eniola Foyi Akashoro. Thank you so much to everyone that made this a success. Those backstage, the producers, every single person that made this a success. Thank you so much, guys. See you next time. Bye.